then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief.
Locusts and wild honey. Locusts symbolizing the bitterness that people experienced when they were in slavery. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. From the God who was, who is, and who is to come, grace, light, and peace be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Lord, we are preparing the way for you. May our hearts and our family be ready to welcome you. As the light from this candle burns brightly, may the blessing of Christ come upon us and brighten our way. Help us to be loving, humble, just, and fair to those around us this week. We ask this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Comfort. Give comfort to my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her service is at an end. Her guilt is expiated. Indeed, she has received from the hand of the Lord double for all her sins. A voice cries out, "In the desert, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in a wasteland a highway for our God. Every valley shall be filled in. Every mountain and hill shall be made low. And rugged land shall be made a plain. A rough country, a broad valley. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Go up on a high mountain, Zion, herald of glad tidings. Cry out at the top of your voice, Jerusalem, herald of good news. Fear not to cry out and say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. Here comes with power the Lord God, who rules by his strong arm. Here is his reward with him, his recompense before him. Like a shepherd, he feeds his flock. In his arms, he gathers the lambs, carrying them in his bosom and leading the ewes with care. The word of the Lord. A proclamation from the second letter of Saint Peter. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. The Lord does not delay his promise, as some regard delay. But he is patient with you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a mighty roar, and the elements will be dissolved by fire, and the earth and everything on it will be found out. Since everything is to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be? Conducting yourselves in holiness and devotion, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved in flames and the elements melted by fire. But according to his promise, we await new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you await these things, be eager to be found without spot or blemish before him, at peace. The word of the Lord.
With you.
And with your spirit.
A proclamation of good news according to Mark. May the Lord be in our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare your way. A voice of one crying out in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight his paths. John the Baptist appeared in the desert, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. People of the whole Judean countryside and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they acknowledged their sins. John was clothed in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He fed on locusts and wild honey. And this is what he proclaimed: "One mightier than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop and loosen the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord. John the Baptist is our focus for this second weekend of Advent. John, who is at a pivotal point between the Hebrew Scriptures, the Christian Scriptures, Old Covenant, New Covenant. John with a foot in both sides of our reality. John who comes. John who is the herald of the one who is to come. You probably know a lot about John the Baptist already. For example, do you know the middle name of John the Baptist? That's it, the. John the Baptist, yes. John the Baptist. John came in order to prepare the way, and there was some concern that they think John was the Messiah. And he went to great lengths to show that he was not. He appeared in the tradition of the prophets, camel's hair, leather belt. He was eating a diet of rather strange food, locusts and wild honey. Locusts symbolizing the bitterness that people experienced when they were in slavery to other human beings, in slavery to their sin. And the wild honey, honey symbolizing the comfort that God came to extend to his people in their bitterness of slavery, in their bitterness of alienation. So John is firmly planted in that role of a prophet, going to great lengths to show he's pointing toward someone else. He is not the one they've been waiting for. He's the herald. He's the voice. He's the one in the wilderness pointing to someone else. Even the symbolism of saying that he's not worthy to untie the sandals of the one who is to come probably hearken for the people of his day the imagery of Pharaoh having his own personal slave that carried his sandals, and John using that imagery to say he's not even worthy to do that. So he goes to great lengths to show he is not the Messiah, but he's pointing toward the Messiah. So John is a very valuable figure for us during our Advent journey. We too are called to be heralds. We too are called to point the way toward the Lord. We who live in the in-between times, in between his first coming, when Jesus was born and ministered, died and rose, and his second coming, whenever that might be. In the early church, they thought it would be in their lifetime. And so we have the second letter of Peter proclaimed today, a letter that's probably the latest written in the New Testament. Peter is saying, we don't know when the Lord will return, but the key is our behavior in the meantime. Peter is calling the people to a lifestyle that will be prepared for whenever the Lord returns, a lifestyle of righteousness, very much in that same tradition of John the Baptist, calling people to turn away from sin and to be open to Jesus. And what a powerful benefit you and I have. John only baptized with water, but he said, someone's coming after me who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. Well, all of us, we have received that baptism in the Holy Spirit by our baptism into the living body and blood of Christ. And so we have that Holy Spirit to access, to enable us to prepare for the Lord's return, whenever that might be, to live in this in-between time and furthering, advancing God's reign, God's agenda of righteousness, God's agenda of reconciliation, compassion, healing, and peace. And so we embrace the Advent call. We are an Advent people, not just these 4 weeks, but really the focus of our entire lives is preparing for the Lord's return. We just have this wonderful concentration of the 4 weeks of Advent to sort of recharge our spiritual batteries so that we can live lifestyles of preparing for the Lord's return. In that in-between time, then, we really are stewards. We really have been entrusted with the mysteries of the kingdom. We've been entrusted with resources. We've been entrusted with many tools, many things in which we can use to invest in God's future coming. And so we thought it would be helpful this weekend of Advent to have a little more of a directed focus on the sense of stewardship. We're all called to be good stewards of all that's put into our hands. And in being good stewards, we will find that we are ready whenever the Lord returns, whenever that might be. Now, there's no need to fear. There's no need to be worried. If we are simply living day in and day out as good stewards of the mysteries and the resources that God has entrusted into our hands. And so we're very blessed this weekend to have two of our parishioners going to share a message on stewardship as a way to kind of cultivate all of us in embracing that call to be good stewards as we prepare for the Lord's return. Frank and Joan Wanner are going to share with us a witness talk to help us appreciate more our calling to be good stewards. Frank and Joan.
Good morning. My name is Frank Wanner, and this is my wife, Joan. We have been members of St. James Parish for over 40 years. We consider ourselves to be very blessed to be part of this vibrant, welcoming Catholic community. Many of you know us, and many of you don't. We try to share our time and talent through various parish activities. Having served as parish council members, trustees, community distributors, and acolytes, now we want to share our feelings on stewardship. God is first in our budget. For us, tithing works. It's just a part of our life. Giving a certain percentage of our good is a good guideline. When our income goes up, our donations go up. When our income goes down, so does our giving. We've had our good times and our not so good times, but we always seem to make it. God knows and understands when we don't give as much as we'd like.
God has blessed each one of us with many gifts, and we are called to use them wisely. Yesterday, when I was reading in our little blue book, The Reflection, part of it says it pretty well. It says, maybe I need to wake up to the reality of my life and say to God, thanks for life, thanks for each day, thanks for a destiny forever. I know everything is all yours, and today I'll try to use well whatever you have given me. I'll try to use my money well. It's yours. Everything that we have does come from God, and so we really need to give some of it back, and through our parish is how we can do that. As Christian stewards, we serve God out of love and gratitude for God's work in the world through the ministries and the programs of our parish. Each one of us is important to continue the life and ministry of our parish. Even now, during these hard times, we must continue to focus on our blessings and be truly grateful for the most important things, life itself, our family, our faith, and our community. We're asked to embrace stewardship as a way of life. In this way, we can show our deep gratitude to God for all of our blessings. Included in your December statement was a parish financial, the 2012 Parish Financial Stewardship Commitment Card. Okay, now we're asking all the families, after prayerful consideration, to return their commitment card next weekend, the 10th and 11th, indicating what financial gift you are going to make to the Lord for the coming year. Now, I know sometimes you will make a commitment and you may lose a job or situations may change. It isn't written in stone. You give what you can. And if you've been faithfully financially supporting our parish, we thank you so much. Please continue to make that commitment that best fits your circumstances. And if you've not given before, please consider making a start now. Every little bit helps, and through your giving, when you can make this commitment, indicating to God what you are going to give, that helps our parish council, our finance committee. It helps them to plan the next year accordingly, and then they can budget. So please try to help out. We feel, you don't give to get back, but for some reason or another, it does always seem to work. God helps us even when we're struggling.
I think what my wife is trying to say is you can never outgive God. God will always give you back more than you can give to him. And if you notice, these only go up to 5% of your income. Years ago, we were told, that you should try to give 10% of your income. That doesn't mean it all to church, but it means to other charities too. So if you want to give more than 5%, be happy, state it. But remember to turn this in next week. We thank you for your attention and for the support you give to our parish. Living as faithful stewards of God's gifts is the best life we can offer. God will do the rest. May we all continue to be blessed by our most wonderful Lord. Thank you.
And thank you, Frank and Joan, for your witness to your lifestyle of stewardship, and encouragement to all of us as well to keep growing as the stewards of the Lord's good gifts. And you referenced the little blue book for Advent. If some of you have not received one yet, there still are additional copies available in the gathering space, just filled with wonderful inspiration to help us during our Advent journey. We're gradually getting used to the new wording for the creed, and so if you would please open to the middle section of your beige pages in your order of worship, and we'll renew our faith together with the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, and who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
Like a shepherd, our God feeds us. In our hunger for justice, peace, and everlasting compassion for those in need, we offer these petitions.
Our response will be, hear us, O Lord. As followers of Jesus, we are to prepare the way of the Lord every day of our lives. We pray that we can move the obstacles out of the way that make it difficult for us to walk with the Lord. O God, we pray.
Hear us, O Lord.
As the baptized, chosen people of God, we are called to reach out to others, the hungry, the homeless, the unemployed, those without sufficient work to support their families. We pray that we will work this week at helping those in need. O God, we pray.
Hear us, O Lord.
For those in positions of leadership, for coaches, catechists, counselors, and confessors, for spiritual directors and all lay leaders may use their influence to teach others by word and example. O God, we pray.
Hear us, O
Lord. For parents, grandparents, and godparents, that they may be worthy models for their children who look to them. O God, we pray.
Hear us, O Lord.
Today we pray for the sick and the weary, those undergoing chemotherapy, radiation, and all the special prayers found in our intentions and on our prayer network. O God, we pray. Isaiah, in our first reading today, envisions a time of peace. We pray for peace in those countries torn by war and violence, especially in Afghanistan and Iraq, the Sudan, and northern Uganda. In those families torn by dissension and separation, in our own hearts as we set aside our angers. O God, we pray.
Hear us, O Lord.
For all those signed in our Book of Life, for Marilyn Marchese, Rosalie Pawlowski, and Bob Monticelli, who recently died. For all those we love and miss, and especially Ed Mason and Joe Marchese, for whom this Eucharist is offered. O God, we pray.
God of love, you bring comfort to your people in their time of need. Hear the prayers we voice today and bring us all closer to the kingdom that never ends. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our presentation song this morning, In the Day of the Lord, found on page 17.
We will sing the refrain two times at the beginning.
Thank you.
By the mingling of this water and wine, may all of us come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share our humanity. Pray, friends, that these are gifts. The many gifts of this Advent season may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. Be pleased, O Lord, with our humble prayers and offerings. And since we have no merits to plead our cause, come, we pray, to our rescue with the protection of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfill the design you formed long ago, and open for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which we now dare to hope. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sin." Do this in memory of me.
Amen.
Therefore, as we celebrate this memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Benedict, our Pope, Jerome, and Donald, our bishops, and all who serve your people. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, our way, our truth, and our life. How happy are we who join in this banquet. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus bring us to life everlasting. Our sisters and brothers who can't be with us are also preparing the way of the Lord, and your bringing the Eucharist to them helps them to do that in joyful hope. And so we send you with our prayer for them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Replenished by the food of spiritual nourishment, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that through our partaking in this mystery, you may teach us to judge wisely the things of earth and hold firm to the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Good morning, everyone. We have just a few announcements this weekend. Next weekend is the final weekend for our 2011 Giving Tree program. Please return all donated gifts to the Giving Tree area in the gathering space by noon on Sunday, December 11th. Thank you for your generosity. There will be blood pressure screening after all masses next weekend in the Great Room. Those parishioners who bought pictures in for our Jacob's Ladder can now pick them up. And finally, evening prayer is this Tuesday at 5:30 p.m. in the chapel. All are invited to attend.
One of our parishioners died this past week, Jeanette Richter. And visitation for Jeanette will be on Tuesday from 9 until 11 in the historic chapel, with her memorial mass at 11 o'clock Tuesday morning in the historic chapel. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, for the mercy of God, rest in peace. And And we have a wonderful event going on this weekend, our annual holidays. So hopefully you can come to the community center and catch some of the festive spirit that you'll find there participating in this year's holidays. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to prepare the way of the Lord.
And as we go forth, let us sing Every Valley on page 15. We will sing verses 1 and 3.